I've got a bunch of old Philips Hue lights, so I thought it might be fun to take one apart and do a bit of hacking. As always, we're sponsored by PCBWay, except in this video, rather than making PCBs, we seem to be breaking PCBs. Let's get on with the show. First off, we need to get inside the thing. You'll want to use a spudger to pry the plastic diffuser away from the base. You're going to be hitting some pretty stubborn silicone sealant, but don't worry, keep working your way around it and eventually it will come slightly loose. Once you've created a small gap, I went for a bit more brute force. I got a screwdriver in there and popped the diffuser off completely. You can just keep going with the spudger, but I got slightly impatient. Just be careful not to damage anything inside. Next up is the inner diffuser. Work on loosening it from the silicone using a screwdriver to pry it up. Finally, with that off, we come to the aluminium PCB with the LEDs on it. This may just pop straight off, it may come off with the internal diffuser. Or you may need to attack some of the surrounding plastic and metal like I did. To pop the base of the light bulb off, I just squashed it in my vise. You may want to find a less destructive way of disassembling this part of the light bulb. Annoyingly, everything is potted. In theory, you should just be able to remove the base and it will just push out. But I found it pretty firmly stuck in, so I had to really go to town on the plastic and metal. I made quite a mess. You may just want to cut through the outside with a hacksaw or Dremel to save yourself a bit of time, along with the inevitable cuts and grazes from sharp metal.
"'Tis but a scratch."
"A scratch? Your arm's off."
Eventually, you can get everything out. The power board and the logic board separate quite easily. The potting compound comes off the power board without too many problems, and we don't need to be too careful as we're not going to try and reuse this PCB. The logic board is a bit more tricky. There's a plastic surround which you need to remove, and once this is done, it's a bit easier to get the compound off and extract the PCB. Unfortunately, the compound is really stuck on, and it's very easy to lose a couple of the small ICs here unless you are very careful. Eventually, you'll end up with this complete mess, and these three PCBs. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail on the power supply board. This takes in mains voltage and produces 5 volts for the logic board, and a higher voltage for driving the LEDs. Probably around 24 volts or so. Let's have a look at the LED PCB. This has an 8-pin socket labelled A to H. B and C are pretty straightforward, we can buzz this out and they connect to the thermistor. The logic board will be monitoring the voltage across this to check for overheating. The rest of the connections were pretty confusing. I wired up my power supply through a resistor and tried all the combinations, and eventually I ended up with this. A and H power the cool white LEDs, H and G power the warm white LEDs, G and F power the blue LED, F and E power the green LED, and E and D power the 2 red LEDs. Initially, I ended up with this slightly confusing schematic, but if you rearrange it a bit and have a look at the logic board, it does start to make slightly more sense. On the logic board, we can see some P-channel MOSFETs. I buzzed out the drain and source of these, and the schematic made lots of sense. Each LED can be bypassed by turning on the MOSFETs, so if you just want to have the blue light, you would turn on these MOSFETs and turn off this MOSFET. It's pretty clever. The driver for the LEDs is connected to pins A and D. The board uses an AP8802 step-down constant current LED driver. This can supply up to 1 amp. Flipping the board over, we can see the resistors that set the drive current. There's 2 1.2 ohm resistors and a 1.3 ohm resistor in parallel. This gives us just over 0.41 ohms. According to the datasheet, this should give us a current of around 0.5 amps. What I find quite clever about this circuit is that only one of these LED driver chips is required. This is a relatively expensive part compared to the other components on the board, which are mostly MOSFETs, transistors, and passive components. Flipping the board over, we can see the MCU. It's an Atmel SAM R21. This is a surprisingly beefy processor. It's a 32-bit ARM Cortex M0 Plus processor with a 2.4 GHz ISM band transceiver. The 2.4 GHz ISM band is set aside for industrial, scientific and medical applications, and the Hue system uses Zigbee, which sits in this band. It's got 256 kilobytes of flash and 32 kilobytes of SRAM and runs at 48 MHz. It's nowhere near our trusty ESP32 in terms of performance, but still pretty good. The antenna is here, along with its matching network of capacitors and inductors. We've also got an ultra-low dropout regulator here that drops the 5 volts from the power board down to 3.3 volts for the MCU. Let's try and power the board up and get it to do something. I've soldered on some wires to the power pins, 5 volts for the logic and 12 volts to power the LEDs, and if we look in the Hue app, we can see that the light is currently unavailable. But as soon as we power it up, it becomes available. It still works. What's more, despite missing a few of the ICs, we can still control the lights, though I suspect we're not getting completely correct colours anymore. If we look at the resistors here, we can see that these are coming from the MCU, and we can surmise that they are being used to drive these ICs, which eventually drive the gates of the P-channel MOSFETs. I suspect that these are wired up something like this, and let the MCU switch the MOSFETs very quickly with the correct voltage. We can work out what each of these MCU outputs corresponds to by changing the colour in the Hue app and probing with our oscilloscope. If we set the hue to red, then we can see that this resistor is being driven. And if we set it to green, we can see it's this one. And for blue, it's this one. That leaves these last two resistors. Switching to this mode in the app, we can see that this one controls the warm white LEDs and this one the cool white LEDs. The only thing we haven't looked at is what's happening on the control pin of the AP8802. This can be used to control the output current. Measuring it with the oscilloscope, it's left floating and it's only pulled low when the light is turned off. Well, that's enough reverse engineering. I think we've got enough information to do a bit of hacking. I've soldered some wires onto the MCU side of the resistors and crimped a connector onto them so we can plug it into some breadboard. I've also connected a resistor between pins B and C so the MCU doesn't think there's a fault with the thermistor. We can drive some LEDs at low power directly from the MCU. I've put in quite a high resistor value of 100 ohms, so we should just be drawing around 1 milliamp or so. Let's jump into the Hue app and see if it works. Well, that's really cool. We can do red, green, blue, and the two white LEDs are working nicely as well. I'm pretty pleased with that. Let's try something a bit more interesting. Does anybody remember my moon lamp project? It's the first electronics project I posted on YouTube. This has an RGB common anode LED, and it's quite high power. Since I've only got red, green, and blue on my LED, I'm combining the white LED signals using an OR gate and then driving some N-channel MOSFETs to turn the red, green, and blue channels on and off. I should probably invest in an RGBW LED to really test this, but it works. My moon lamp is now controlled from the Hue app. We can turn it red, we can turn it green, and we can turn it blue, and we can even get it to go white. It's really cool. We've got all the controls of the Hue app at our disposal. So that was a pretty fun bit of reverse engineering, and a surprisingly easy hack if you ignore all the effort getting into the thing. The Hue bulbs are quite expensive still, so I'm not sure if this is really worthwhile. But it was great fun. I'll see you in the next video.